Hello everyone, welcome to Wonder Lab. Today let's talk about real-time PCR data analysis. We are going to learn about the basics of analyzing real-time qPCR data, little bit about absolute quantification and more about relative quantification methods. Before we start, I would suggest you to watch previous related videos. Now let's get started. During each PCR cycle, we measure the amount of fluorescent signal for each DNA template in our samples. At first, I mean early cycles, you can see fluorescent signal at background level, which is called initiation phase. In each cycle, product will be double and accumulate, and we have exponential phase. Eventually, the cycle number will be recorded when fluorescent signal crosses signal threshold, which is called CT value or threshold cycle. CT value is used to measure the concentration of DNA in the reaction. Before we continue, you can see here, other than threshold line, we have a baseline. This baseline normally generated automatically by real-time PCR application. Also, you can set it manually, especially with some cyber assays. CT values depends on several factors. For example, the quality of RNA extraction, cDNA synthesis, and the amount of template in samples affect CT value. For example, let's say we have two samples. One of them is 14 nanogram per microliter, and another one is 4 picogram per microliter. Here, the sample with higher concentration takes less cycles to cross threshold line, while 4 picogram sample takes more cycle to cross the line and generate signal. So for conclusion, lower CT means we have higher amount of template in our sample, and higher CT means we have lower concentration of template in our samples. We have two common methods for real-time qPCR data analysis, absolute quantification and relative quantification. It's up to you which one to select. In absolute quantification, you need a standard curve to estimate DNA quantity. For relative quantification, you can use one or more reference gene or a unit mass to normalize data. If you want to normalize based on unit mass, you must select a sample as calibrator and compare the expression of your target gene with it, and then calculate ratio. Note here, to perform this method, you must measure a starting amount of RNA that added to your reaction to know exactly the accurate quantification of a starting template. You can see here the appropriate equation you can use for this method. The alphabet E here stands for efficiency. You can calculate it with a slope of a standard curve. For this, you have to perform serial dilution from template and conduct real-time PCR and draw a standard curve. Well, sometimes it's not possible to conduct another real-time PCR to calculate efficiency. You can do in this situation. Well, there are some applications such as LINREC helps you to calculate efficiency by data you obtained from your sample. Now let's see how to normalize against reference gene. We have three common methods for that: Livak or ΔΔCt method, ΔΔCt method, and Pfaffle method. To perform Livak method, efficiency of 100% is expected, and you need to perform three steps. First, you have to normalize CT of target gene to CT of reference gene. For the second step, you must normalize ΔΔCt of your gene of interest to calibrator. And for final step, calculate fault difference. ΔΔCt method is almost like Livak method, and this is appropriate equation for this method. Now what about Pfaffle method, when we can use it? If your target and reference gene have different efficiency, you can use this method. Now let's work on an example together to learn more about Livak or ΔΔCt method. Now let's learn how to analyze data by ΔΔCt method. here I had 4 samples, including 2 controlled and 2 treated samples. You may have normal sample and tumor sample, whatever your experiment is. You can see that I conducted 3 repeats for each sample and calculate CT for my target gene or gene of interest and compare it with GAPDH as a reference gene. Please pause the video here and have a better look how I wrote these values and numbers in the first table. As I mentioned, I performed 3 repeats, so let's first average these CT values for gene of interest and GAPDH. Now let's calculate ΔΔCt with this equation. Gene of interest CT value minus GAPDH CT value would be our ΔΔCt. Now to calculate ΔΔCt, you must select a reference or calibrator. To do this, you can average the ΔΔCt of control. Now you can calculate ΔΔCt for all your samples. Now that you calculate ΔΔCt for last and final step, you can report it based on fold change. If you calculate 2 to power of negative ΔΔCt for each sample, you will have fold change. Please keep in mind that a positive ΔΔCt shows upregulation and negative values shows downregulation. Congratulations, it's done! You successfully performed ΔΔCt method. Thank you for watching this video in Wonderlab. Don't forget to like, subscribe, and share it with your friends. Also, if you hit bell icon, you will receive notification for new videos in Wonderlab. So, see you next week!